Inga mana, inga reo, inga karanga ranga maha o ngā matawaka, me ngā momo tangata katoa o te huine, tēnā koutou katoa. It is great to be here, just 76 days out from this election, which has come just in time. And I'm not sure if the Prime Minister called an early election because he's also scared of the damage he's doing to working people and decided to cut them a break. Or maybe it's just, as people say, he predicted that the dodgy characters in his coalition would be fully exposed by this time and he would have no majority anymore to do any further damage. He had planned to finish in a flurry by removing the tea breaks and the lunch breaks from working people. But he was unable to pass that law because, as it turned out, no one was saving Mr. Banks. And so the tea break lives on. I want to take a minute to acknowledge you, David. You've been great to work with in the leadership role, and you've given us lots of time and energy into our priorities and campaigns, and you will be a great Prime Minister. And can I also acknowledge Darian Fenton? Where is she? Oh, down there. Darian, you're standing down at this election, but you've been a true champion of working people, and I know you will continue to do so. Endless, from the port dispute, the AFCO dispute, the Hobbit dispute, and the forestry campaign, you have done the yards with us, and you're highly regarded by the union members in this country, and we salute you. And I want to acknowledge our affiliates that we share with you, sitting behind me here. They are all working hard for a change of government, and I know you appreciate their support, as I do. And also Richard Wagstaff, the Vice President of the Council of Trade Unions. And I want to take the opportunity to congratulate the party, both in the Parliament and its members, on the work that you are doing on policy. Because for working people, the policy direction gives us hope. It mitigates the fear that many workers live with day to day. The fear of not being able to pay the rent or the power on payday. The fear of not having enough money for food. Fear that if the car breaks down, they'll have to give up their employment because they can't afford to get it fixed. Fear that their younger kids don't see enough of them and that their older kids will be forever churning through crappy and insecure, low-paid jobs without any access to training, without decent pay, without any reciprocity in the employment relationship, and fear for the security of employment for the whole family in an economy that is narrowing down to the farm gate because this government's lack of foresight and lack of ambition. Your policy platform replaces fear with hope and confidence. Hope that the future will be better than the past. Hope that the role that everyone plays in the economy will be fairly recognised. Confidence that there is a plan to create jobs in New Zealand, including by adding value to our primary products, through investment in research and design, by creating levers for productive investment, and by using government procurement to build manufacturing strengths, and of course by investing in education. That is the type of future that we want to see. And to just go off point a little bit, can I say how excited I was by the school donation policy? It is so good. And it's small in a way, but it says so much about how the party is connected to the real issues in the community and is prepared to step in what can only be a win-win for governments and for kids with such a simple solution. And it's a Labor solution. National can moan on about it as they channel our taxes into their embarrassing charter school failure, but it won't wash. It's about priorities, and they should be ashamed of theirs. What was interesting when the announcement was made was the response from the few that complained about it. They said that Labor was shifting the cost of donations and education from families to taxpayers. And that is how far the rhetoric has gone about what taxes are to do in this country. And these families are taxpayers. And the bulk of our community wants our children to be able to go to school paid for by our taxes. So congratulations. As I said, this is a just-in-time election, and boy has it been a tough 6 years for working people. They have seen their rights as workers depleted at the same time as being hard hit by the global financial crisis, which has destroyed job after job, and the impact of those law changes has been very real. And can I tell you, for example, the average remuneration in dairy farming decreased last year, while the average number of hours of work increased. And can you believe that? A decrease in remuneration in dairy, while dairy prices have been so high and the dairy industry has been growing. And let me tell you that wages are already low in dairy, with the average hourly rate across all jobs at only $18.44 per hour. 67% of farmers said last year that they had provided no formal training to their staff at all last year. And 42% of dairy workers in farms had worked less than 1 year, had less than 1 year experience, with 87% less than 5 years. And I'm not a big fan, it's true to say, of farm employment practices, but this is actually bad for our farming industry. It is a failure in one of our most important sectors, and one of the few industries, the few select industries that the government actually fawns over and panders to, for example, changing the minimum wage calculations for it. It allows it to bring in migrant workers freely, meaning 20% of the lowest skilled jobs on farms are filled by migrants. It huffs and puffs about the accident rate in the agriculture sector, 38 deaths in the sector in the last 2 years. And only two prosecutions, but its employment record is a disaster. This industry needs employment law that forces it to consider collectively the interest of its workers through collective bargaining and allows it to plan. It needs collective bargaining to plan for its future workforce. Collective bargaining will ensure workers get a fair share, but in turn will build a sustainable workforce for the dairy industry in its own interest. And my sneak peek at Labor's IR policy gives me confidence that for farmers and farm workers, this election is just in time. And what about that other booming sector, construction? 50% of the workers engaged in the Canterbury rebuild are on labour hire contracts. That is, they are not employed by the construction firms, but by third parties that offer them day-to-day work in many cases. So let's have a look at one of these big labour hire companies, New Zealand Labour Limited. It's got an 0800 number, 0800 Muscle. And it appears to me that that is how it sees these workers, simply as muscle. I have one of their standard contracts. Firstly, if you want employment with them, you have to agree that out of your first pay will come an $18 fee for a high visibility vest, $20 for a hard hat, and $70 for a pair of boots, and then they will charge you a delivery fee of $50. Of course, the law requires the employer to provide safety gear like that. But what labour hire worker is in a position to enforce the law? And next, you have to agree to pay for your own site-safe passport. That's another $130, basic health and safety training, and for ease of administration, that comes out of your first pay too. And this is what workers like in national so-called rockstar economy. Labour hire workers get no reciprocity from the construction companies that benefit from their work. They get no industry training. This year's ACC entitlement claims by labour hire workers show that 30 a week are being injured to the standard of making an ACC entitlement claim to ACC. And many of them are turning up there to find that technically they're self-employed, should have paid their own levies, and are not entitled to ACC rehabilitation or compensation. And there's very little chance of workplace rehabilitation when you're a labour hire worker, as there is no job to return to. It is a crock. And working life, when the government removes rights and rewards short-termism, is a very bad experience. And for many of these workers, They will be working on projects directly connected with the government. And what do all these industries show us? Farming, construction, and you know about forestry. They show us that there is no link anymore between productivity improvements, profits, and fair working conditions. We know there is a strong link between fairness and collective bargaining, and that is what we need to see more of. I spoke to you about forestry last time I spoke. The 10 deaths last year, the 900 serious harm injuries in 5 years, the long hours these workers are doing to make a living. And now the export log prices are falling. The New Zealand log milling industry has been destroyed with the high dollar and the unaffordability of logs while the export price has been so strong. And there has been a total lack of government interest and support for this industry in either planning, procurement preference or in any other form. And mills have closed down all over the country with mill workers losing their jobs in the hundreds. And now we could have a buffer in the fall of export prices by having a strong internal market and processing wood here. But it's too late, and forestry workers are being laid off around the country just as the industry has started to get safer and to build a union and to act together to some extent. They're all losing their jobs. And there's no redundancy, no notice, and they fall into communities where everything else is shut down. And for what? We need industry strategies that develop long-term thinking, that doesn't just back the glamour jobs in exchange for photo opportunities, but that backs the companies and workers in this country that are prepared to invest and produce and design and develop and train and to treat workers well. On the positive side, despite another three workers being seriously harmed only last week, the accident rate in forestry has actually almost halved this year under the pressure of the union campaign. It's no time to be complacent, and that rate is still unacceptable, but it proves two things in my mind. It proves that the rate could have been halved last year, and the year before, and the year before that, and the year before that, but no one demanded that that be so. And it also proves that the union matters in this industry. These families, these brave, brave, staunch families in their communities, have taken a stand because of union support, and they have halved the accident rate. It's not sustainable, really, because we can't keep up this pressure forever, and so the structure needs to change to make it safe. But it shows it can be done. And worse, it shows that last year's rate was unavoidable, as was avoidable, as was all the heartache that that represented. And I have to say for forestry workers, this election is just in time. Labor's policy to lift minimum wages twice in the first year, to introduce industry standard agreements, to reinstate the rights that workers have lost over the last 6 years, including getting rid of laws like the 90-day law and restoring the rights to workers to meet with their union, will make a significant difference to the working people of this country. The commitment to pay the living wage to government workers will make a real difference to those families that work in the government sector after 6 years of endless cuts. It is exciting to have a positive plan, an achievable plan, a fair plan for a better New Zealand so close and so in reach. And you have to keep fighting to extend paid parental leave. We almost got there this time, and I'm proud of the collaboration between us on the 26th for Babies campaign. You know, fairness and decency is our thing. It's a value that sits squarely in our joint space. And it's not one that the national government even thinks to claim as a goal. Kiwis want their New Zealand back. We need a government that gives working people a reassurance that our future will be better and stronger and that respects their basic humanity, their right to work reasonable hours, to earn reasonable income, to have reasonable opportunity and to participate equally in their community. This election is just in time for us all. The union movement and the Labor Party share the same values. We understand what New Zealand can be when government acts in the broad interest of the people. We are looking forward to a change of government in just a few short months, and while it will be just in time, it can't come soon enough. Thank you very much.